Alright, hello everyone, welcome back to Persona. I am SIMSteven, also known as Master Fenral. And we're kind of starting right back off where we left from last time. However, I did a little bit of off-screen grinding, and I've gotten Ellen and Yuki's first Persona up to the maximum rank. We're going to get the terminology right today. So, Personas have two things that are very important. First, I'm going to go and look at the status screen first so we can kind of talk about my persona level to make what's coming up make a little bit more sense. So notice how everyone has a actual level and then they have the persona level. And what the persona level does is that affects the rate of growth of your personas. Basically, in order to rank up your personas, you have to cast magic from the personas several times until their rank goes up. Now, keeping in mind that we have our own personal persona levels, take a look at our actual personas. Notice how the level is 5 plus 4. That is level 5, rank 4. And, for example, Ellen and Yuki have their personas at level 6, rank 8. And Nike is also level 7, rank 8. So what the levels means is that I believe if your persona level is 10 levels higher than your persona's actual level, then the number of times you have to cast that persona goes down significantly. Otherwise, it's going to take about 200 some odd castings to get your persona all the way up to rank 8. Otherwise, it's going to be like 70 some. I looked at some kind of wikia for persona. I think it's like Shin Megami Tensei wikia, which the persona series is part of the Shin Megami Tensei series as well. It's just different kinds of, you know, different flavors of RPGs between the two series. Either way, Yuki's Vista is level 6 at rank 8, so that's as high as it will go. Personas don't actually level up, just they rank up. So there's kind of a bit of a difference there. And all the level means is how quickly you can rank up your persona based on, you know, your own personal persona levels. So once again, if you're 10 levels higher, it is much easier to rank up your persona to get all their spells and such. And I believe there's more mechanics that go into this that we'll be getting into later, but eventually we're going to be able to start fusing personas and dismissing personas and just kind of mixing and matching everything that we could possibly want to do with personas, because they're kind of like a pet system. And I think something happens if you dismiss a persona, get rid of them permanently once they've ranked up to level 8. I think you get some kind of item if you do that, but that's only if you're trying to min-max the game. It shouldn't be something you really need to worry about. So, I'm going to kind of show how I went about grinding persona levels, as well as just kind of show off some of the powers that they have. So, let's see here. I'm going to use a couple of Vesta's most powerful spells, since you're unlikely to see these spells throughout the normal course of the game, as well as Ellen's if you don't use her as your fifth party member. So we're going to start with Red Fire. Normally it can hit multiple targets, but I'm going to try and single out one of these enemies here if I possibly can. I guess not. Alright, so let's see here. Let's just have Ellen kill off that one there. And we'll get to see a bit of a showcase of these two's first personas and most of their spells as well. Oh, they absorb holy magic. That wasn't good. Either way, what I would like to do is show how I went about grinding persona levels, since it took me like about an hour or two. And it's not all that easy. Also, we haven't seen these enemies before, I don't think. They're just kind of, what are they called? Fruman. Okay. They also have max fear. Maybe because we started fighting them? I'm not 100% sure, but I'm going to make myself defend once again. And yeah, we can take one of these guys out with Blastmore. And then we just have Ellen defend right now. So, here is Vesta's strongest spell. Although it didn't really do all that much. But if we were to see these guys get, or if we were to attack these guys with some of our strongest spells and it was going against their weaknesses, they would do a whole lot more damage, I bet. Anyways, this is kind of what I did to rank up my personas. If at any point in time you need to restore your SP, you could just go to a clinic and pay a small fee. The one, I think, in Joy Street only costs $10 for all five of us. And, well, it's not all that much, especially since you can kind of get that much in a single battle sometimes. Either way, I did two cure spells in that last round of combat just to kind of show off how I went about going and using tons of spells to rank up my personas. If you use the auto battle command replay, you can just kind of set your controller down, as I just did there on the desk. I don't know if you heard that, but that was me setting my controller down. And what you can do is just set it on auto battle, find like a weak group of enemies, and just possibly have one off to the side. That guy's in the center, but what I usually did was I would get like either a group of slimes, or, well, I would leave one slime alive or a zombie or something like that. And I would just let it go like this for a little while until I pretty much ran out of SP. And this is the most efficient way to rank up your personas. It's just to kind of use spells that help your own group. And just like healing spells for stuff like healing spells like Yuki and Ellen had. And just kind of let them cast over and over and over again. And this is a good way to rank up lots and lots of castings. Is that you don't even have to be here to watch the game play itself out. You could just let it go, and for example, if you had the zombie or something off to the side, off to the left or the right, you can have Ellen and Yuki cast their cure spells on the two of your characters that are off to the side that are most likely to be hit by that enemy. So, for example, if that guy was off on the left side, I would have Ellen and Yuki heal myself and Ellen, and there wouldn't be anything he could do because we'd heal off any damage that he would do, and just kind of let it go for a while, and you get a lot of castings, and that's a good way to rank up your personas. Anyways, we're gonna end this auto battle cycle here real quick, and from here on out, I think we can see Ellen's strongest spell, and if she doesn't kill this guy off, that is. And we haven't seen Sonar yet, so let's use that. In fact, I don't think we've seen Icy yet either. So let's see both of these spells. We'll try to get in one more fight before we head back to the school, which is where we need to go next to get Nancy some medical attention, because obviously the hospital is out of the question. And of course, as Ellen said at the end of the last cutscene, the police station has been taken over by monsters. So, I guess if there were any emergency workers left, it'd be the firefighters? yeah, this town is effed up. Either way, speaking of which, let me out of here! Why can't I leave this town? Please, somebody help me! So there's a random person here trying to get through the rainbow-colored barrier, but he can't because, well, it's a rainbow-colored barrier, and there's no way a normal human can break through it. Everyone's kind of crazy. I feel sad for him. Alright, well, let's get in one more battle before we get to the school again. And, oh, by the way, something I should have mentioned earlier is before I started up this episode, I unequipped the bullets that I had equipped to myself, Mark, and Nate before doing the cutscene in the shrine. This is probably something that's only going to affect me and people who did casino grinding after the monsters started invading the town, because you can actually start fighting monsters and getting money and therefore buy tokens from the casinos, and then you can buy bullets from the casinos, but you can't buy actual guns. pretty soon in the story, we're going to be getting actual guns. And that's kind of why I unequipped the bullets, because I don't know if I'm going to screw myself or not out of getting some more items, because I like to collect every item I possibly can as early as I possibly can, because I'm just kind of that type of item hoarding type of guy. Alright, so I see, let's just cast that on one of the pixies. That should hit multiple targets, but they're kind of spread out here, so yeah, we can't really hit all of them all at once. Anyways, there's Redfire again. We saw the last battle. And I believe this is her strongest, or maybe it's her second strongest attack with that particular persona. And yeah, this is why I don't ever attack pixies with wind magic. I myself have a wind persona equipped that reflects wind magic, and I think pixies also have wind magic as well, which is why they cast it on me, and why it reflected back on them. So that's one good benefit of having personas that actually are elemental based, is that they give you an advantage over that particular element. Anyways, one more round of some of the strongest spells we can see out of these two. And I think after this, Yuki is going to leave us permanently, since we're not able to do the Snow Queen quest, which was exclusive to the Japanese PS1 version, but they actually finished it for the PSP re-release. And so when this game came out on the PSP, we finally got to be able to play the Snow Queen quest. However, since I am doing this on an original PS1 copy, yes, this is a legitimate disc. This is not emulated in the slightest. We are not able to do the Snow Queen quest because that was unfinished for the American release. So we literally only got half the game because they couldn't finish translating that version of the quest, that other secondary main storyline. That you either do one or the other. It's kind of like how it reminds me of Front Mission 3, in fact, where for those of us who got it in America, Front Mission 3 is like a tactical RPG game with giant mechs. But it was by Square on PS1 as well, and based on some of the decisions you make early game, you play either one of two stories, and it's a full game for each of the stories. So it's kind of the same thing that happens here in Persona, is that there's two full stories, but you only get to play one at a time. Otherwise, you have to start a whole new game and start from there. Anyways, we're at the gates of the school, and we need to get inside. No, you must say the password. I can't let you in if you don't. I know it. Roses are red, zombies are blue, but my face is white, so you know I'm true. Oh, okay, you can pass. That's quite the password. Simple nursery rhyme, but it really makes sense in the situation that we're in. Alright, so we are back at the school at last, and we haven't been here since the first episode that we did all that time ago. Anyways, oh Steve, and this is my teacher. I think she's my homeroom teacher, and if I remember right, her bio said that she was a very kind and caring teacher. So, kind of explains what she's kind of going on about here. Is everyone okay? I'm so glad you're safe. What happened to her? I'll explain later. Quickly, we must take her to the infirmary. Okay, Steve, come with me to the infirmary. Yuki, Ellen, can you two go to that hole in the wall? Lana and TJ are trying to fill that hole up. Please go and help them. Just make sure the demons can get in, right? Okay, let's go, Ellen. Let's. And off they go. So, these two are no longer temporary party members, and we're kind of by ourselves this time around. Once again, I've unequipped the bullets that I had equipped, because sooner or later we're going to be getting actual guns, which is kind of why I haven't actually talked about that in battle yet. But eventually, we're going to be able to start using guns, and that will allow us to have a ranged attack when our melee attacks are normally not that long of a range. Either way, So Nancy's kind of giving us a summary, which is why we faded to black before we entered the infirmary. So we kind of know what's going on here in town, and that Sebec is the one behind all these strange goings-ons and all the monsters roaming around the streets. So what's going on here? Can you believe them, Steve? I'm sorry, but please can you please go the whole wall and tell them not to close it? Mark and Nate might be coming back that way. Oh. That's right, they don't know the password to get inside the gate. And here's that nurse girl we saw once again at the beginning of the game. But of course we haven't seen her in quite a while because we haven't been here to the school since the very first episode. Anyways, her wound isn't that bad. She'll be fine. About you, Steve? Are you okay? Here, let me take a look. So yeah, doctors serve the same function as, for example, inns in most other RPGs, in that they restore you back to full HP and SP. And of course, I think they also get rid of any status ailments as well that you might be afflicted with. And once again, the Augustus trees are your save points. This one right here is just a baby tree that's here in the clinic, so we can use this one to save our game. So, we're not going to be able to get out of this school for a little while, just to let you know about that. We're kind of locked in here as a result of stories, so if you want to go back out to the world map and do some grinding or some fighting or go do some gambling, yeah, we're not going to be able to leave for a little while. We're not going to be here that long, if memory serves me right. But we aren't able to leave by ourselves until we get our party members back. Anyways, can we talk to Mary? Or Nancy? Not Mary. This is Mary's mom. Can't thank you people enough. Yeah, she got grazed by a bullet, in case you forgot. I don't think she actually got shot. She probably just got... You know, the bullet kind of passed really close to her body and probably took off some skin or something. I don't know. But either way, this guy's no Vital in the wall. Yeah, I don't know if we actually saw this back in the first episode, but there's a pathway that leads between the main area of the school and I think the gym. And it's kind of straight back down this hallway on the first floor. And there's a small room between the main area of the school, where all the classrooms are located in, and the gym area. And there's a hole in the wall that, before the whole story started, I think someone was playing a prank and blew a hole in this wall. So, yeah. This is kind of a convenient back door to get in from the outside. And Alana here is one of the potential fifth party members. In fact, if we've done everything correctly to recruit Chris, or if we haven't done everything correctly to recruit Chris, as I should be saying, if we haven't done everything to recruit Chris, then she will be forced into your party as the fifth party member. But that is for something down the road a little bit later that we'll be getting into, but there's a point in time where you're going to either get all five of your party members. They're not going to leave you without a fifth party member. So we heard about that factory. When we eventually go to the factory, Alana will be there. And if you have not met all the requirements to recruit Chris by that point, she will actually force her way into your party. Otherwise, we can get Brad or Ellen. Brad's another character we met on the first episode, and we're actually going to see him again fairly soon. But those are two other potential fifth party members. And Yuki, of course, once again, is unavailable for this particular story. Either way, hey Steve, Ellen went outside alone. I tried to stop her, but she wouldn't listen. You know how she is. What if there's actually an exit out of town? Okay, so Ellen went down that way. TJ is just a side character. She's not a party member, but she is another student here, and she does have a portrait, but I don't think she has the ability to use Persona. At least I don't think so. Either way, she's not a party member. Anyways, I think Yuki's still somewhere around the school. Said she was going to look for something to plug that hole with. Okay, so we talked about the lady. I wonder if this place would be really safe if we plug this hole. Oh, what? We're not gonna plug it in. Oh well. Okay, so what happens if we go out the hole? Hey, Steve, you're going already? And it's Beck, right? That's what it's intended. It's impossible. Just forget it. Hmm? Oh. Well, looky who it is. It's Mary? Oh, Steve, what are you guys doing? What are you doing, Mary? Weren't you in the hospital? Oh, is that you, Mary? Once again, what's she doing here? yeah, everyone's surprised to see that she's up and walking around and not being confined to a hospital bed. Yeah, that's me, the one and only Mary the Magnificent. What's wrong, Lana? Steve, this is too strange. Mary was never this happy and giggly. What's going on? Lana, what are you talking about? Oh, that big hole. Steve, you did it, right? Well, no, I don't think I did. Either way, see, something is wrong. Weren't you just in the hospital? Lana, stop it. You're really starting to upset me. Prefer that I was in the hospital? I think she's the real Mary. How can you tell? She could be a demon or something. Sorry, but she's carrying her favorite compact. She's never without it. Lana, stop badgering TJ. But TJ, there's something definitely not right around here. Yeah, you? Whatever, there's Nate. Hey, he came in the back door. Steve, what? Why is Mary here? Yeah, he's just as shocked. And she's like, wait, what's going on? Why is everyone saying I should be in the hospital? Stop talking around, Nate. By the way, what's wrong? Your face looks flushed and upset. I'm not upset. I'm just out of breath from running back here. That idiot Mark got caught by demons at the police. Why? Weren't you just going to the factory, not the police station? Oh, well, he's going to explain right here. Mark thought it was a good idea to obtain weapons and ammo for extra protection. That's when he got caught. Normally, I wouldn't think twice about leaving that idiot there to die, but he's got the security card. Had to help me go and rescue him. Mark, demons, Steve, you have to rescue him. Hell, here's a gun. Using a persona greatly decreases your energy level. That's how Mark got caught. It won't hurt to be prepared. Don't forget to put the gun. Alright, so yes, we do get guns now. I thought this was going to be a little bit later once we go to the police station and then we get guns, but I guess Mark gave us some guns, or I guess Nate swiped a few before he left. And left Mark, well, to bite the dust. But either way, we gotta go get him back. Anyway, persona, I don't understand it very well. Oh well. Let's go. Alright, well, he did say don't forget to equip our guns, so... yeah, this is why I unequipped the bullet, because I think these new guns that we get come with ammo, but I was possibly thinking about things a little bit wrong. Nate gets an M16. Isn't that like an automatic gun of some sort? Okay, gauntlet. Oh, by the way, I did get another gauntlet while I was off-screen doing my craning. And why did you get all unequipped? Either way... this is kind of also why I did all that casino grinding, is because I get some pretty good stuff right off at the beginning of the game. And let's see here. Blind shot. I think those are things I bought from the casino. Any good shoes? No, just regular old cloth stuff. Either way, Mary uses bows. Nate has two-handed swords, of course, and I have one-handed swords. So, Mary is one of our four permanent party members that we start the game with. And this is unchanging throughout any particular story of the game. She is always required, Same thing as Nate and Mark. Since we're obviously going to go get Mark back, yeah, he's going to be coming back to the party after we go rescue him. Please, please be careful. So yeah, this particular Mary, what about a girl in black? What do you know about some girl in black? Alright, so yeah, let's get going to the police station and go grab Mark and save him from the demons once again. Anyways, let's hurry. By the way, what exactly is police? This is no time for a joke. Joke? No, really. What is it? A government organization that keeps the peace and order in society. Therefore, we are going to the police station. Get it? I'm slowly remembering something. Or am I? Maybe she's got amnesia? What? What? The gym? What's brand new? When did they rebuild it? It was redone 6 months ago while you were in the hospital. There you go again. I was never hospitalized. Stop kidding around. Hey, Steve. Is she suffering from amnesia? Maybe you shouldn't take her along. What are you guys mumbling about? We're wasting time. Mark's in danger. Behind you! Humans are dangerous. I'm going to eat you. Oh, really? Let's see then. Alright. So, also another reason why I did all that grinding. We have yet another Persona Awakening battle. So that means we get an automatic level up once we're done with this. We can't lose. Fortunately, Mark's not here to share that, unfortunately. Either way, yeah, we still gotta do this regardless. So, let's get this going. Mary, don't push it. And of course, we miss completely because we don't have the personas. But either way, that's a really good bow because it hits three times. So, once again, really good idea to get as many coins and do some better gambling early on because you get some really powerful gear to start off with. Uh-oh. It's Persona Awakening time. And she is Ice Elemental. Either way, we get a free level up, like I said. So, I think, by the way, I think that red bar is stats given to you by having a certain persona equipped. I thought it was from your equipment before, but I'm pretty sure that's a boost given to you by your persona. So, in my case, since I like having all stats pretty balanced, and because the red bar can particularly change, or could potentially change, based on what persona you have equipped, I'm going to try and keep the yellow bars particularly even. And I think after this, we should be able to change up our personas as we go through this next portion of the game. But we're probably going to have to save the police station and some of that persona management for next time, because we're pretty much going to start wrapping things up here. We're not quite at that point, but the next time I get to a save point, which will probably be in the Sun Mall, if I'm not mistaken, we're going to wrap things up there. So, either way, we got to see Mary's first usage of a persona. So not only does she just kind of appear out of the blue from her incident in the hospital, and not only does she not really remember anything or remember things correctly, but she also right off the bat gets her persona as well. So if you couldn't tell, she is definitely important to the story in some way somehow, but we don't quite know just yet what that is. But either way, that was my persona, a power from my mind, another self within me. Persona is a Latin word which means mask. From this word, English words such as personality were derived. There are demons and angels coexisting within our souls. If you want to be poetic, an eye for an eye and a demon for a demon. But not that I won't understand how it works, but it could prove to be very useful. We can do it! We can find out why demons have invaded and defeat them! We can take our city back! Yes, but we do that, we have to go rescue that idiot Mark. Shall we go now, Steve? Alright, so... let's rearrange our party a little bit. Let's put Mary kind of in the back there, because she has a bow and arrow. And that makes it so that she can attack from long range. So I think I will go with this for now. Steve and Nate are in the front of the party since they have shorter range weapons, whereas a bow, like Mary has, is a bit longer range and she can attack from farther in the back row. Anyways, I'm not going to save this formation. I don't really plan to get back attacked. And if I do, I'll just have to change the formation after a fight. So, we're going to pretty much make a beeline to the police station between now and the next episode. And I'll not let that girl do what she wants. That's right, Steve. We don't know who this girl in black is that you're talking about, Mary. Anyway, we're going to get out of the school here and head off to the police station, but we're going to make a stop at one of the malls on the way there. Alright, so Guido's behind all this, and we are not going to let him get away with this. At least that's what Mark says. But we're probably going to see who this guy is eventually in the future. Now though, Sun Mall is straight ahead, so let's hurry along, find the next save point, and then head to the police station in the next episode. So we should be about ready to wrap things up here in just a moment. Also, I can get rid of these two, get rid of these demons, because I have their spell cards. And speaking of spell cards, I actually did poke around in the menus a little bit more. I'm kind of relearning this game bit by bit. Been a long time since I played this, but there are a lot of things I remember about it because I played through this portion of the game several times, but I just haven't gone through like the second half of the game or so. Never really finished the game, which is kind of why I want to do a let's play of this game. So let's keep on going. And I wanted to show something else I discovered or rediscovered as I was doing some off-screen grinding. So in the magic menu, you go to card, you can see we have 11 cards. And I was actually talking about this last time, that we can only hold 12 cards at a time. Yeah, could have just gotten to this menu to see which ones I have. Either way, Sun Mall should be straight ahead, and there should be a save point here in the Sun Mall. So once we find that save point, we should be able to wrap things up here and call it a day. And I don't know if a particular store is open. We're going to actually take a really quick peek to see if they're open yet. But they weren't open before we went to the shrine. And I think there's a reason why that store wasn't open by then. It's known as the Velvet Room. And if you played the other Persona games, you probably know what that is. Because I think this is a staple of the series. It's where we actually go to make new Personas and make use of those cards that we were talking about just a minute ago. So, yeah, we're going to take a quick peek to see if the Velvet Room is open, because by now we should no longer have to be, or by now we no longer have our temporary party members, which were Yuki and Ellen, so I don't think there's any reason why we shouldn't be able to go to the Velvet Room. So, let's see, can we actually go inside? No, not yet. Probably have to get Mark back before that happens, but once again, this is where we're going to go to create our new personas, but we can't do that just yet. We're still locked out of being able to do that. But next time, we'll be heading off to the police station, and from that point on, we'll finally get to the point where we can actually make use of all our party members. And I just want to show where the police station is. It's just straight down the road, pretty much. And once we cross the next street, the next main street, we should be right there at the police station. And if memory serves me, it's not that long of a dungeon, so we should be able to do it in a single episode. Some of these dungeons get pretty long, so we might have to split some of them up per multiple episodes. But either way, I think I have babbled on long enough today. So, I am SIMSteven, also known as Master Fenrel. Thanks for watching, and I will see you guys next time.